right here. He organizes these workshops. If you get to know him, he's the nicer of the two of us.
He's the good cop.
Yeah, he's the good cop to my bad cop. But he's also an insightful person. So if you ever have questions, you can ask me, of course, and that's great. But frankly, Dave might answer him even better. Which now you're wondering, why the hell am I? He's not. I'm not selling this well, am I? But I have a little question to start tonight off with. It's going to sound rude. It's going to sound a little arrogant. Just accept that for the moment. We're going to answer it very positively, though. We can answer it throughout the rest of the night very positively. So as I ask this question, I'm not trying to attack. I'm just trying to get us to think. So I've got a little bit of background first. Dave has been a trainer for 10-plus years. He owns a gym in Birmingham, Alabama. It's doing very well. We travel the country together and do these workshops. He puts out a lot of content. I have been doing this for over 20 years. I have a gym in Sacramento, California called Body Tribe Fitness. I travel the country teaching workshops. I have a huge amount of output via YouTube and DVDs and books. And then Dan John, who's here tomorrow, he's been doing this for 30-plus years. His level of output is amazing as well. If you don't know who he is, you should. And I know a few other people, even in the New York City area, that are fairly proficient in doing some really good work. So I want to ask you this. Let's pretend we all sort of lived in the same area. We don't. I'm from California, Birmingham, Alabama, Bend, Oregon. But let's pretend we sort of all lived in the same area. Here's the question. It doesn't sound great at all. But why would somebody come to you instead of us? You don't have to answer that right now. That's what we're going to talk about tonight. We've got a huge amount of experience. We have a huge amount of output. We kind of know what we're doing. And we've been doing it for a long time. And to toot our own horns, we're pretty good at it. Why would somebody come to you? Now, don't worry. I know it sounds horribly arrogant of me, but don't worry. We're going to answer this as the night goes on. Because they should. If you go down this little journey that we're all going to go with tonight, they should come to you. Now, the first thing is, if you guys said, well, price, maybe we're cheaper than you. You guys don't know us very well. We do so much low-income or pro bono work. The industry leaders often make fun of us because we don't make the money we supposedly deserve. And we're okay with that. I'd rather have people who can't afford me come regularly than the rich clients who, as we were talking earlier, don't always show up. So we give a lot of training away. We do a lot of low-discount training. We do a lot of giving back to the community. So if you think it's price that people would come to you first, not for a second. Let's talk about this thing up on the board here, though. This begins our journey. The four aspects of training. This sums up what we do. Now, when people answer that question initially, why should somebody come to me, they often go, well, because my personality is better than yours. And you would be right. Your personality probably is better than mine. You're probably a friendlier person. You're probably more of a motivator. I'm kind of a pain in the ass. Ask Dave. So maybe you're right. And a lot of trainers survive solely on this. Jillian Michaels, what's his name, with the Blackfire program, Tracy Anderson. This is where they live. They have horrible program design. We don't know what their technique work is. There's no purpose to what they do. The fitness industrial complex thrives on personality. So if you first say, well, because I'm a friendlier person than you are, great. Today we're going to dig a little deeper than that. These first three don't matter if we haven't dug into purpose. And that's what we're going to talk about a little bit today. Let's start by asking a question that is much easier to answer. And you don't have to answer it from your own experience or even from your client's experience, just people in general. Why do people work out? What are some reasons? Look, I got the little dry erase pen and everything, so now you have to give me some reasons.
Aesthetics.
Big one, right? I'm going to call that, we call this the scale and the mirror. Anything else? It's funny how the room goes quiet after aesthetics.
They're afraid of death.
Longevity. Afraid of death is a great one.
Trying to avoid pain.
Pain avoidance. Longevity is an interesting one. Pain avoidance it goes along with what I'm about to say. We are really good as a nation of dying longer. Most of us aren't living longer, we're just dying longer. So hopefully we can, yeah, change that a little bit and make it make a greater life rather than just a slower death. Anything else?
Stress reliever.
There's a one giant theme to all this. Roll it. Make a better version of me. And not me, but you, me, and your client, me. And so when a client comes to us, this is ultimately their goal. It's what everything we can come up with in this list leads to. So we have to teach them what of these is actually worthwhile and what isn't necessarily helping this goal. And we have to design our program towards this. And here's where it gets fun and horrible all at the same time. We are masters at lying to ourselves about what this means. And we can create all these programs and workouts that actually aren't necessarily leading to this, but we've built in so much cognitive dissonance to our belief system that we believe that they are. So we have to let go of a lot of dogma to achieve this. And part of that dogma is going to start with up here. Scale in the mirror, the very first thing that most people think about when they come through the door. Now, I'm not going to say that there's anything wrong with this. We all want to look better, except for Dave, because he's perfect in every way. But the rest of us all want to look better. I'll give you a statistic that'll highlight what I'm talking about. If you look at the statistics from plastic surgery, elective plastic surgery, not because you decided to take on a lawnmower in a battle, but because you want to change how you look. It's not like your face got ripped off by a walrus or something like that. The people who actually elect to have their something on them transformed through plastic surgery, what do you think the percentage is of people who, through their lifetime, once they get something done, only have that one thing done? Yeah, it's almost zero. Because what they discovered was this isn't really working on making a better version of yourself. Have you, do you guys ever watch, okay, there's the HGTV Home and Garden Network. Yeah, you're all nodding your head. I do too. Why? Why do we watch that? It's the most mind-numbing TV, and I think that's why we watch it. We can just shut down. So it's like the default channel when I turn on the TV, and I'm transfixed. And so there's shows where they flip houses. You know, they renovate a house, and then they sell it. And oftentimes they're selling one house, and this couple who owns the house, and this family who owns the house, can go and buy another house, and then they have to renovate that one. So there's a lot of renovating going on. And I will give this channel, though, some serious credit. Because when I say couple or family, there are so many non-traditional families and couples on this show. It's great. There's the two guys who have adopted children, or the two women who have been together for 20 years. It's not the traditional straight family, so I give the channel credit for featuring how life in America should really look. So hats off to them. But anyway, they flip a house. There's not a lot of anticipation or a climax to the flipping of a house, right? So, but in these shows, they have to make it that way, so there's always that, oh, God, moment. And it's when they're taking up the floors or they're painting the walls. They're taking up the floors because they got to put better looking floors on them. The floors are ugly. They take up the floors and they realize, wow, there's no flooring underneath this at all except for dreams and mice. Or they're painting the wall and the paintbrush goes through the wall and they realize, wow, these walls are made of cottage cheese. It's that oh God moment where they realize the foundation of the house just isn't holding up and putting a nice coat of paint on it is not making it a better house. It's that, oh God, moment. That's, I think, what happens a lot, although they don't have that realization, but that's the goal. We're going to paint the exterior of a horrible foundation house. There's a quote I was telling Dave the other day. I used to work with contractors. I painted houses for a summer, and a lot of different contractors I worked with, and one of them gave me this little nugget of a quote that seems more relevant to our industry than it does to contracting. It was a beautiful quote. And he said, a well-built house holds paint better. And it took me years to figure out what the hell he meant. And it might take you years to figure it out too, but I bet you can see where it's going anyways. We need to work on the foundation. The problem is when people set goals, they only set goals from experience, from what they've been told or what they know. And so when they come to us and they have goals, they're going to have these goals where they've been bombarded by the media. And the media is telling them this, the scale in the mirror, scale in the mirror. You only get better through the scale in the mirror. The problem is the fitness industry is a big part of that media too. we're doing the same thing. All the trainers out there, the celebrity trainers, and people selling gadgets and gizmos. What the hell were we watching that little video? This new product. The same thing has been around for 100 years, but now they're reselling it
in multiple colors.
Multiple colors. You can twist your fat away. So there's all these. Even from the industry itself, all this media telling us that this is the important thing. So when a client comes to us, of course they're going to think that's what it is. That's what the goal of fitness is. So here's the bummer of having clients come to us when it comes to goals. They have no idea how to set actual fitness goals. We're going to have to be ambassadors for real purpose. So now we're going to delve into real purpose a little bit. I'm going to erase some of this. I'm going to keep stealing your up there because I'm going to keep picking on it. So there's a common fallacy right now in the fitness industry where this ends up sort of being the goal. So we sell getting tired. And that's our big thing now. We love selling getting tired. But somehow, we believe that tired equals a better version of that. First and foremost, get your clients tired. That sums up so much of program design for this industry right now. You're even going to have clients that you might be teaching them new stuff. They didn't walk out of there feeling like they had their ass handed to them, so they're going to get mad at you. We didn't get tired. I'm not tired. We can't admit that this is our goal. So then we start making up stories. Well, I'm getting tired, therefore I must be doing something right. Because we know that when you build skills, if you were to work on building skills, you would get tired. So what's the inverse logic? Well, therefore, because I'm getting tired, I must be building skills. And that's the big fallacy in the industry right now. We believe that, oh, well, we got tired. We got exhausted. Therefore, we're good at stuff. We can do things. Now, I'm often in a room of trainers, kind of like tonight. This might be the case tonight, too. But it's often the case where I'm in a room of trainers, and I'm teaching the trainers. I'm talking to the trainers. Most of the people in the room can probably outwork out me. Like, if there was a workout on the board and there's a time table and all your names are up there, I'd probably be in the bottom somewhere. And yet, my job this weekend is to show people how to actually move. I'm going to show you the stuff you can't do or should be doing better. Because we should be practicing movement before we practice exercise. Getting great at exercising doesn't automatically have crossover to the real world. But because we're getting tired and we've convinced ourselves that that's important, we believe we're actually doing something. So, here's my goal. Let's get tired because we're actually building skills. Real skills, the skills that we can go live a life with. Getting good at being in the gym is not a real worthwhile skill. Using the gym so we can get the hell out of the gym, now that's the skill we need to work on. And so when we look at program design, we have to start asking ourselves, are the things in our program actually affecting that goal of getting good at stuff? Which leads to, what do I mean by getting good at stuff? I still feel like keeping this stuff up here, don't I? Make a better version of yourself. We know that that's sort of everyone's big blanket goal. Here's a question. It's so Joe's birthday, he can ask anything he wants.
Us as trainers realizing that clients think that way, yeah. Being tired equals a better workout.
Yeah.
So at the end of the workout, we're going to do something to raise their heart rate. Just so they feel like they got a better workout at the end. Is that us reinforcing that fallacy?
It can be. Now, I would say yes, because we really do end up reinforcing it. We make them crave that rather than the actual skill building. So, I'll address that a little bit. That's actually a good question.
That's actually a great question.
See? A little older, a little smarter. Skills. One thing I try to get everybody to concentrate on, especially as trainers, is learning to teach movement before we teach exercise. And understanding the difference between the two. Because as human adults, especially in our Western society, people don't know that there's a difference. They think all movement is now exercise. Okay, you guys are all kind of young. I grew up in the 70s. And in the 70s, I know you guys are like, wow, We had better TV, first of all. Better music.
Yeah,
suck it. And so, anyway, in the 70s, we grew up in the, I grew up in the 70s, Dave did too. He's old too.
Aww.
Yeah, sorry. But yeah. What?
I did too.
Awesome. You look so much younger than me though.
73. I did too.
Oh my gosh. Does everybody in New York just look younger? Is that a thing? Good Lord. And so you know what I'm talking about. Awesome 70s. So anyway, we played when we were kids, didn't we? We, if you're anything like we were, you went outside at some point in the day, at some point in the day you came home. In that time period, you did stuff as a kid. You explored your neighborhood. Dave uses the term boundaries. Our boundaries were so much bigger back then. And I don't know what it's like in a city like this. It must be much trickier in a city, but I grew up here. Yes, I know, envy me. I grew up in Hawaii. And in Hawaii, we got to play. We got to go up in the, I'm not making this up. We got to go up in the mountains, and that very same day, just down the street to the ocean. It was that awesome. And I know a lot of kids don't get that experience, but back in the 70s, I think we did a lot more. We walked to school all the time. I don't know if kids do that anymore. But they do this in New York City. I watched a bunch of kids walk to school from school today. That sounded almost creepy. We just walked by some schools of children, and they were leaving. They were walking home with their parents, and it was adorable. They all stopped at the ice cream truck. That was great. It was a big ice cream truck, and they were all piled up by it. But I think there's this, we put more and more limits on children. I don't really know what children do today, because I think so many of them are literally twiddling their thumbs. When we're kids, we don't judge movement. And this is an important thing to remember. When we're kids, we go, let's try it. What's up there? Let's go there. What's down there? Let's try that. What's over here? What does this feel like when I do this? We just explore. We don't judge movement. And then something happens in our teenage years. I remember I was around 12 years old. When you're 12 years old, you pretend you're older. You want to be older. You're a pre-adult, and you're hoping to be an adult. And you don't want to be called out for being childish. So you don't go over to a friend's house and ask them to come out and play anymore. I remember specifically telling myself that, you can't do that, Jeff, you can't do that, because they're going to make fun of you. So when you get into your teenage years, at least this was my experience, and I come across this a lot with adults, you have two choices, movement-wise. You either stop, or you start playing a sport. I didn't play a sport. I wasn't an athlete in my teenage years. I got beat up by the athletes. It was classic cliques, you know, the jocks, and I was the little geek who occasionally smoke pot behind the bleachers. And the jocks wanted to beat up the geeks, and so that's what they did. And it was the classic John Hughes type scenario. So you have those two choices. You play sports, which is, in high school, what's it about? Is it about play and fun? No, it's about win at all costs. And that carries on with you until college, if you get to keep playing sport into college. Or you don't do much, and you keep not doing much. And then by the time you're in your 20s, you keep getting bombarded with the media that says, oh, well, you have to exercise. You don't hear the media saying, oh, you have to move. You have to play. You have to go have some fun. It says, you have to exercise. You have to move at this time with these tools, at this place, gives you all these categories. Movement is now a product, and it's sold to you. So when people come to you, when an adult comes to you, they've probably had many years of being sold this. And then they show up at your doorstep, and your goal is to go, okay, wait, let's actually show you what movement is, because it's not just exercise. And this is a little earth-changing, because this industry doesn't get this yet. So I'm hoping you guys can help me out and start teaching movement first. When I work with a client, and those of you who are going on with me this weekend and will learn more from me this weekend, you'll see what I do at the beginning. We just start rolling around on the floor and playing. We start exploring movement. They learn all these basic techniques, and the best part is I learn all about them. Just by having people explore movement, I can learn how they move. I can assess them without having to test them. I don't run a single test on a new client. Can you imagine showing up for your first day of school? And they just test you right out of the gates. First day of math, and they're like, here's your math test. Wait a minute, you haven't taught me a single thing yet. And that's sort of what happens in the training world a lot. People show up and they're like, let's test you. So here's this great number. We were talking about this number earlier. About 80 to 85% of our general population doesn't participate in purposeful movement. We are the 15%. We're at the upper end of the 15%. Well, we actually are teaching the 15%. There's 85% of our population not participating. Now, we can call them lazy, we can call them scared, or we can look at ourselves and go, our recruiting program sucks. Because if you look at what our initiation program is for that 85%, it's not great. It's usually very clinical, or it's very intimidating. There's all these things that are not getting that 85% to want to join us in our journeys. And I think a lot of it has to do is because the first thing they're going to do is exercise. We need to treat them and ourselves like that 8-year-old kid. Not treat them like a child, treat them like a playful, explorational, curious entity. That will get them more excited about movement than fitness. The idea, the common idea of what fitness is. So we can start adjusting our sights on how we treat a new person. Hopefully we can be ambassadors that for the 85%, not just the 15% talking to ourselves. That's what I see a lot on my feed, my Facebook feed, I'm friends with thousands of people. But I look at my feed and all the training stuff that shows up on my feed, and I just see a lot of stuff that I know the 85% would look at and go, I don't want to do that. Our bodies have one purpose. Move. That's what this is for. It's to move. We have a built-in computer system. We have a built-in fuel and machine system. And then the body's supposed to move. What we're really good at in this society is not doing that. We've made everything so efficient that bodies don't move anymore. So we got to get bodies moving again. The thing is, we're trying to appeal to the brain, to the adult brain, rather than the childlike body. This body does not age like the adult brain does. How many of you have dogs or cats? Wow, that's a low number. I guess you're in New York City, right? Oh, yeah. I want to cry a little. I'm such a huge dog and cat person. We have a situation at my gym, because we're not in New York City where it's really hard to walk your dogs. We have a situation where we rescue animals all the time. For some reason, we've just become this rescue center. People just know that's what we do, so they keep bringing them to us. Or when they literally show up at the gym, stray dogs running through our parking lot. Oh God, here's another one. We're going chasing down the street. So, anyway, we're huge dog and cat people. If you have had dogs or cats in the past, you know something about them. As they age, they don't age like we do. There's a 16-year-old cat where we're staying right now. I wouldn't have known that cat was 16. That's a dead cat, basically, walking. That's an old kitty cat. This cat hops up, plays around, can play with a toy. I've heard stories of how this cat does really amazing things. Cat doesn't like us very much, so we don't see it do all this stuff, but we've heard of how great this cat is. My cat at home is pretty old, I think 11 years old now. You wouldn't know it. Acts just like that cat did when he was 1 year old. We have a bunch of dogs at our gym. The oldest one's probably 10 or 11. If you jingle the keys, that 10 or 11-year-old dog just says, hey, I'm ready to go, let's go. And goes and tears it up at the river. We take them to the river every day. Their bodies don't understand the aging process like we do. Our brains get involved, and our brains start controlling the body and telling the body, you're supposed to be old and decrepit and falling apart. We're talking about peaking, remember? We're supposed to peak by the time we're 25, and then it's just downhill after that. That's 20-plus years of me going downhill then. I'm not thrilled by that, and that's not how it actually works. If our brains can constantly gain knowledge, constantly grow, constantly expand, why can't our bodies keep learning and keep exploring and keep being curious? That's another thing to let people know. I don't know if any of you get to work with high-level athletes. High-level athletes, unfortunately, usually go through that route. They peak. They start doing this. They only start doing this because they peaked at one thing. They peaked at their sport. They peaked at that one thing they love doing. and they had to break their body apart to do it. You know why? Most people get to that point without actually learning movement. When I teach a new client, whether they're part of the 85% or whether they're a high-ranking athlete, I reduce them all to the same place. And so what I'm going to talk about now is skills, a basic foundation level of skills. Because what that elite athlete did was they got good at one of those, the rest of them are still down here. So I have to bring them back down here. So I treat newcomers, whether they're elite level athletes or fresh off the couch, pretty much the exact same. And that is start with movement. This elite level athlete that I was talking about, that person probably never learned movement properly. What happens when you do that? You compensate. You get really good at that one thing, but you probably didn't learn movement properly, so you compensated the heck out of it, and your body took you to that place in a potentially dangerous way because you forced it to. It was your trained lion. When you train a lion, you whip the crap out of it and you get it to do your tricks. You don't form a bond with it. Our goal is form a bond with it. Let's have a relationship with our bodies, and hopefully we can introduce people to their bodies instead of to this painting a foundation that's falling apart idea of what their body is.